Two, safety. One thing about being a silverback, the strength of eight men thing can come in handy. Ivan starts with the bunny and the dachshund, one in each arm, along with the two cats perched on his shoulder and head. One more trip, this time with the beagle and Snickers, and then Boss, and more on our way. Ruby holds tight to Gray's muzzle's collar, and he manages to paddle alongside her, using Ruby as a ballast. It takes us a while to cross the street. The current's swift, and the water's up to Ruby's neck in places. Ivan, I asked as we approached the other side, did they find George and Julia? They are okay. A little banged up, but fine. They made it safely to a keeper's shed. Tree fell and blocked the door. I choked back a sob of relief. George was looking out for you when Ruby and I left. How? How did you find me? Ruby saw which way you were running, says Ivan. And don't forget that gorillas and elephants have great noses, Bob. Maybe not dog level, but not bad. We followed your stink, Uncle Bob, Ruby exclaims. When we reach for the far side, I see where Ivan has deposited our fellow inmates, the parking lot of a donut shop. The lights inside are off, like everywhere else, but I glimpse a few flickering candles and people are milling about. Come on, everybody, Ivan calls. Let's get you inside. I'm hoping these folks won't mind a bit of company. As we gather at the entrance, Boss pauses. I'm gonna head out, she says, avoiding my gaze. What? I demand. I just found you. You can't leave now. She hesitates. The puppy. Thought maybe I'd check. I mean, I know he probably gone. She looks at the muddy pavement. It's crazy, I know. Yes, I say firmly. It is crazy. Besides, you're too weak and your paw is injured. My voice grows urgent. Think about it, Boss. What are the odds he stayed in that car and waited for you? Who knows where he is by now? Yeah, she looks defeated. I suppose you're right. What's wrong, Bob? Ivan asks. My sister. Whoa, wait. This is your sister, Uncle Bob? Ruby interrupts, turning to Boss. Then, that means you're my aunt? Boss has a puppy, I explain. Stuck in a car near the bridge. I point with my nose. Ivan doesn't know this way around town the way I do. That way, not far. She wants to try to find him, but, well, you know, it's probably long gone by now. I know my words are harsh, but I'm trying to protect Boss. No way that puppy is still alive. Ivan strokes his chin. Why don't we get everyone settled inside, he suggests. Then we can figure this out. Never mind, Boss says. Bob's right. It's nuts. Way too dangerous. And probably too late anyway. She takes a deep breath. He's not exactly the first pup I've lost. You think I'd be used to this by now, wouldn't you? I don't know what to say. I don't want to make her pain go away, but what can I do? I'm no bigger than Boss is, and certainly no smarter, and I've got my own problems. My busted nose, my aching foot, my angry stomach. Look out for numero uno. That's my motto for a reason. It's kept me alive this long. Then, to my surprise, some fool blurts, I'll go find him. And apparently, it's me. Yeah, we'll go, Ivan says. Yeah, more swimming, Ruby cries. It's not safe, Ruby, I say. You have to stay here, I promise, Akilo. I'd watch out for you. I made it this far, she says, donning her elephant pout face. Ivan and I sigh. It's exhausting, all this responsibility, this worry, this love. Promise to stay close, I ask. She holds up her trunk. Elephant's honor. Cause Akilo. I'll make dog soup out of me if anything happens to you. Yuck, Ruby giggles. Hey, did you know I can almost do a somersault in the water, Uncle Bob? Ivan taps politely on the door to the donut shop, but even a polite knock from a gorilla sounds like a visit from a wrecking ball. The door opens a crack. I think two or three people may have fainted, but we can't say to find out. I hop onto Ivan's shoulder and the three of us head off. I glance behind me to see Boss standing on the pavement watching us. In the darkness and rain, I can't read her eyes, but I'd like to think there's hope in them. Traffic stop. We slug up a slight hill and round a corner. The traffic lights are out and nobody seems to be on the streets, that is, until we cut through a stand of palm trees and come across some polite officers in a slow-moving squad car, its blue and red lights circling. "Attention," one of the officers announces over a loudspeaker. "This area is under a mandatory evacuation order. Do not." The announcement stops and so does the car. "Uh-oh," says Ruby. "I think they spotted us," I say. "We're kind of hard to miss," Ivan points out. The car moves closer, so close that I can see dropped jaws and bulging eyes. The car breaks to a stop. The driver's side door flies open and one of the officers jumps out. The officer, a skinny young guy, follows suit, but he looks annoyed. "What are you doing?" he says. "Don't be a hero. We could have stayed in the car where it's safe." "I am looking," says the driver into her radio receiver, "at a gorilla and an elephant, and the gorilla has a tiny dog on his shoulder. And no, I have not been drinking." "They said the park got hit by the tornado," says the skinny officer, carefully aiming his pistol. "We can't exactly shoot a gorilla," the driver says. And I like the way she's thinking. "Try me." "What's his crime exactly? Jaywalking?" The thing is, "I love elephants," says the driver. "My daughter collects stuffed elephants. I mean, you know, stuffed toys, not stuffed real ones." She listens to her radio for a moment. "Get animal control out here," says the skinny officer. "Get a van, get a moving truck, get a 747. I don't care." "Ivan," I whisper in his ear, "this is not looking good. You and Ruby gotta stay put. Don't make any sudden moves. No funny business, okay? These guys are freaking out." Ivan sits down on the ground. Slowly, very, very slowly, Ruby settles next to him. The driver smiles. "Aw, that's so cute." Skinny officer nods. "Yeah, in a deadly kind of way." "I gotta do this," I say to my friends. "If you stay calm, they won't mess with you." "But Bob," worry clouds Ivan's face. "You need us." "What I need is for you to stay alive," I reply. I can see he isn't going to listen to reason, so I try a different approach. "Ivan," I say, "it's like this. Boss is my sister. I let her down once, and now, well, I have a second chance. I'll explain it all later, but I need to do this." Ivan looks at the officers, guns drawn, then nods. "You are the one and only Bob," he says. "You got this, pal." I leap into the air, into the vast unknown, just like Kimu did. Well, maybe not quite so elegantly, but I do my best. Lightning and fireworks. It isn't far to the bridge, but far is relative when the wind is blowing down houses like the big bad wolf. I watch a stop sign fly past. I navigate around trees, scattered like popsicle sticks. I keep an eye out for gators and pythons. Lightning strikes a tree. I brace for the thunder. It shakes the earth, the air, my teeth, my bones. A branch falls on a power line. Sparks dance like fireworks. I hate fireworks. I move with more care after that. I know enough to stay away from downed power lines, thanks to the Weather Channel and storm chasers. Man, I love TV. I give anything to be watching it from my nice cozy bed right about now. Good thing I know where the bridge is. My swollen nose throbs. What's the point in owning a top-of-the-line sniffer if it's not working right? When I pass a bird's nest on the ground, I offer to help the owner, a jay. She swears at me. At least I think she does. I hear nuts and some other interesting words. I tend to forget that in some circles, dogs are considered predators. I wonder how Kimo and the other escapees are doing. One thing I know for sure, having been on the inside and the outside, is that way too much of the world ain't made for wild animals. How would a meerkat cross a highway? How would a panther face down a city block? How would a wolf survive an encounter with a gun? For that matter, who do I think I am, playing hero? Nutwit was right. I'm soft. I'm slow. I'm not a street dog anymore. I'm a pampered, lazy pooch. I hear the rush of water, a different sound from the pouring rain, and out of nowhere, there it is, the creek. Boss mentioned that the car was near the bridge, but when I get close, I remember what the officer at the shelter said. The bridge had collapsed. And then I see it. A little car, round-topped, floating, caught in a dislodged tree at the edge of the roaring creek, not far from the crumbled remains of the bridge. And on top of the car, even though it's completely impossible, is a puppy waiting. And all I can think is, the dog is a nincompoop. And here's a picture.